We want to welcome this morning. We are glad that you are here, and we just want to come in this morning rejoicing, celebrating all that God has done. And man, it is a privilege each and every week that we get to come in and we get to celebrate Him, we get to worship Him, and we pray that is your desire as we've come into His presence, is that we would truly worship, is that we would truly celebrate, and we can put away everything else that's going on, we can put away every distraction, but ultimately say we are here that He may get the blessing from our worship, and we pray that's your desire. Man, it isn't something we just do out of habit. It isn't something we do out of routine. But we look forward to coming into His house each and every week where we can come and truly celebrate Him. Let's go to the Lord in prayer and pray a blessing over our worship today as we celebrate Him. Father, I thank You so much for the privilege that we have, the opportunity that we have just to truly come and to meet with You this morning in a mighty way. And Lord, we come with expectancy. We come expecting to hear from You. We don't come because it's what we do. We don't come because it's Sunday. We don't come because we do it and that's what we're supposed to do on Sunday. We come because we expect to hear from You. So right now, we pray that we open our hearts, we open our minds, and we truly are receptive to exactly what You want us to have this morning. We thank You and we love You. In Your name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand together. Let's welcome the Holy Spirit this morning. Sing the short chorus with us this morning.
Holy Spirit.
This morning, welcome them here this morning and say, we're glad to see you here at First Real Baptist Church this morning as well.
Standing on this mountaintop, looking just how far we've come, knowing that for every step. Battleground, seeing just how much You've done, knowing every victory was Your power in us. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can say. Thank you. struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, never once did we ever walk alone. Carried by your constant grace, held within your perfect peace. Never once, no, we never walk alone. Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did you leave us on our own. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. Every step we are breathing in your grace. Evermore we'll be breathing out your praise. You are.
Each day, His love will find a way.
Amen. I'm telling you, Matthew, you're going to have to get that eye problem fixed, buddy. Listen, I want to say really quickly what an honor it has been, and I'm thankful for this church allowing me to serve in the capacity I'm serving in right now as a youth pastor. Been a part of these students' lives for a while, and this is a different capacity for me. But I'm so thankful for their hearts. As you've seen the pictures, that's just not even a glimpse of how great these students are. And as we celebrate today, as we come in graduation Sunday, we're so thankful. And as a church, we need to be praying for our high school seniors as they step into this new life, this new path where they may have face new challenges. They need to know that their church is behind them 100%. They need to know that we're praying for them and that we're thinking about them. So at this time, we'll have them come up. First up, we've got Miss Natalie Arnold. Miss Natalie was the valedictorian this year at Volunteer High School, and that deserves a round of applause. She got that from her mama. Amen. Miss Natalie, look. You have to stand right there in the front as you come up. Stand up there, Natalie. Next is Miss Adria Christian. Everybody give Adria a hand as she comes up. Miss Adria has had a hard week. Her mama followed around with the camera, taking pictures as she was crying. Miss Adria, love you. Next is up is Mr. Taylor Lane, or as I call him, Skeeter Bazaar. Now, I've watched Taylor grow up from a little kid, okay? So I feel really old right now. Love you, buddy. Miss Hannah Ryder. Miss Hannah Ryder. And last but not least, Mr. Matthew Rutledge. We got them a ESV study Bible, and in that Bible thing, there is another gift, okay? Use that to buy a Chris Tomlin CD, okay? Take with you to college. At this time, we'll have our seniors go to the front here, stand in front of the steps. We'll ask the parents and siblings to come up with them, and Stephen's going to offer a prayer over them.
That we certainly remember mom and dad too. This is a transition for all of them. This is a transition as they make their way here. Man, these are the people that pack lunches. These are the people that stay up late and help with homework assignments. These are the people, seniors, that your accomplishments, they help enable you to do those and have those accomplishments. And man, I'm thankful for godly parents. Thankful for godly parents that set the tone. And so what I want to do this morning is pray a prayer of dedication over these seniors. And I also want to pray for mom and dad. And as a group, as we have them up here, I certainly want you as a church. And one of the reasons I brought them up here this morning is as a church, let these faces ingrain in your mind, because this is the beginning. This is a transition, but these parents, continue to pray for these parents and continue to pray for these students. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, I thank you so much. I thank you for a church that has a heartbeat for students. I thank you that for a church that views their accomplishments and celebrates with them this morning. Lord, what an incredible journey. But may they understand that this journey is just beginning. May they understand that this is the start of many great things.
Father, as I watch video of them growing up, I see tremendous potential. Lord, they're gifted, they're talented. And Lord, how you will use this group of students and how you can use this group of students is beyond my comprehension. So Lord, you take this group of students and their accomplishments and you take them far greater than we could ever imagine as a church, and you far exceed our expectations. And now, Father, I pray a special prayer over some moms and dads, because this is tough for them, and let them know it's okay to cry. Let them know it's okay to laugh. Let them know it's okay to smile. And Lord, I thank you for the parents that have taken time, that have taken energy, that have taken effort, that have sacrificed for their students and for their accomplishments. And so, Father, this morning I pray a prayer of blessing over these students, but not only the students, but the parents as well, that you, as they embark on this new stage in life, that you will be with them every step of the way, and that you will use this step as a landmark of where you began something incredibly special, and you use them to do something incredible for you. I thank you and I love you. In your name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Let's give another round of applause. Guys can be seated. We want to recognize really quickly, we have some other graduates here today. Volunteer High School, they're not in the program. Colleen Garman, Sierra Sampson. Also, as I read your name, if you're a college graduate, please stand up. We want to recognize you this morning. Graduated from East Tennessee State University, Kayla Bell, the Bachelor of Science in Education. Is Kayla? Where's she at? There she is. She's on a different side today. Remain standing, okay? Miss Jordan Sierra Britton, Bachelor of Science in Biology and Minor in Education. I don't believe she's here today. Tyler Hensley, Bachelor of Science in Education. Right back there. Stephanie Vaughn, also graduating from ETSU, Bachelor of Science in Allied Health with a concentration in radiography. From Carson Newman College, graduated from Carson Newman College, Thomas Jennings, Bachelor of Science in Biology. And from Tusculum College, Alex Wiedemann, Bachelor of Arts in Mathematics, minor in Chemistry and Biology. And I don't believe he's here this morning. Let's give him a round of hand. We appreciate you guys. See me after the service. We have a gift for you also, so you're not left out, okay? We appreciate you guys. As this time, as the praise team comes up, this is a special day as we celebrate our graduates, as we come together, as we worship Him. As a church, as Stephen said, we need to pray for the students. We need to pray for our parents of those students. And as we go into our service, as we go into our worship time, as we lift Him up in song, let our hearts be connected to God this morning. Let our hearts transcend to Him this morning. Let His presence fill this place. Let the Holy Spirit fill. He can come in our hearts. He can come in our midst as we worship Him. Because truly, we are worshiping the great I Am. He is worthy of our praise. Amen. Let's all stand together. Sing this with Steph. Ooh.
before me. The demons run and flee at the mention of the name, King of Majesty. There is no power in hell or any who can stand before the power and the presence of the great I Am. 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 Hallelujah. Holy, holy God Almighty. Great I Am. Who is worthy? None beside thee. God Almighty. Great I Am. Great I Am.
We want to be close, close to your side. So heaven is real and death is a lie.
Let's continue worshiping this morning.
The splendor of the King. Clothed in majesty. Let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, oh, when darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great the land.
Lord, I let us just go to the Lord in prayer just for a minute. Lord, Lord, in Psalms it says that you really are great. And sometimes I think we sing it, and Lord, it's so real to me this morning. It's so real in your presence. And Lord, I would be doing a disjustice and a disservice to you if I let us just keep going. But I wanted to stop this morning. I wanted to stop what we were doing, and I wanted us to say, Lord, you are great. And you are worthy of our praise. In Psalm 145, verse 3, it says, great is the Lord and greatly to be praised, and greatness is unsearchable. And I'm so thankful for your greatness. I'm so thankful for your great love and your mercy and your grace and your forgiveness. And so, Lord, this isn't part of our program. This isn't part of our order of worship, but it's your worship. This is what we have for you. So, Lord, this morning, we're not going to stop. We're going to sing through this chorus one more time. And, man, we worship you. We give you our worship. Because I believe what Psalm 45 says, great is the Lord and worthy is to be praised. And so may we do that this morning. And may we give you our praise. Let's sing together one more time.
How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see.
Said, we forget how greater God is, and we overlook how greater God is. We're getting ready to sing. Listen, I'm so excited. And you say, why are you so excited? It's because I know personally the Savior that is great in my life. That one day you come and receive his bride. And there's no greater song that I can think of right now than the old hymn, How Great Thou Art. What we're going to do, we're going to sing this last verse, this song. We're going to finish with that chorus. Just proclaim how great he is this morning.
When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Shall bow in humble adoration.
In church, sing this with me.
And there proclaim, my God, how great thou art.
How great.
Can you help me get excited? Amen. We worship you, Savior.
Amen. It's worship services like this that makes me not want to preach, but then on the same hand, it makes me want to preach, you know, because from the same token, I just want to continue to worship and to continue to praise Him, but at the same token, I'm ready to go, so you guys are in for it. But man, I tell you, it's been a good week, and I just look forward to what the Lord has for us this morning. Man, I tell you what, I'm going to speak somewhat to the graduates this morning, but man, I think there are some principles that each and every one of us can apply as well. What do we want to be known for? What I mean by that is, man, do we want to be known for being the individual that walked across the stage and received the accolades of graduating high school? Do we want to be known as the employee that won Employee of the Month the most times throughout the year? What do we want to be known for? Do we want to be known for being the smartest, the best, the most athletic? Man, I'm telling you, I struggle with this idea of what I want to be known for. And man, there's nothing that speaks what I want to be known for more than Hebrews chapter 11. Man, Hebrews chapter 11, I did an extensive study a while back on Hebrews chapter 11 because Hebrews chapter 11 fascinates me. Because what Hebrews chapter 11 is, for those who don't know, it is a picture of basically the most faithful people in all the world. And they compile them in Hebrews chapter 11. And man, I tell you, while you're turning there, man, I struggle with this thing because, man, I don't know what I want to be known for, all right? I'll just be completely honest with you. Here's the thing. Nikki gets onto me all the time because I don't have just one hobby. Like, some people like to hunt. Some people like to fish. Some people like to cook. Some people like to do different things. I like to do a lot of different things, and I haven't really completely outlined what I want to do or what I want to be known for. For example, I'm going to give you an example. Here's the thing. I get on these kicks for a while. For a while, it was fishing. I'm telling you, I wanted to be the best fisherman. I bought the latest rods, the latest reels. I knew the best line to have. I knew the best baits to have. I knew where fish would bite. I knew what times they would bite. I ordered and prescribed to fishing magazine. I'm telling you, I was eat up with it, and I get engrossed into these hobbies, and I'm like, man, I'm going to be a fisherman. That's what I want to be. I want to be Bill Dance without the Tennessee hat. I want to be that, right? That's what I want to be. And then that move to, I want to be tennis. Tennis became that thing for me. And man, you guys laugh, but I'm telling you, I got into tennis and literally, when I do stuff, I don't just go and go to Walmart and get a tennis racket and try it to see if I like it. No, if I'm going to play tennis, I'm going to play tennis. And I go to the tennis store, and I buy a $300 racket, tennis shoes that you can only wear on tennis courts. There is such a thing. And I'm telling you, and I get engrossed in this thing called tennis, and I start playing. And I'm telling you, when I say I play, I would play like 4 hours at a time, 4 and 5 hours at a time. And I would love it. I'm going to play tennis. I'm going to watch it on TV. I'm going to read about how I can become better. I'm going to watch YouTube videos of how to serve better. And I'm telling you, I just got engrossed with this thing, and that's how I am. It's weird. And then I went through this weightlifting spell where I'm going to be Mr. Universe and I would lift weights all the time. And then I went through this spell where I wanted to run a marathon and I got up to 14 miles and then Addison came along and then that ruined that dream. But man, right now, just recently, this past week, and it literally was this past week, I've decided that I'm going to start playing golf. I don't know why that's so funny to you, but I have decided that's what I'm going to do. And so, man, I've been out. I've been reading. I've been watching YouTube videos. I'm telling you, I'm going to learn to play golf. And I'm telling you, I don't know what it is. I struggle with identity at times because I have all these things. And Nikki, I'm telling you, I came home just this week and I said, Nikki, I know you don't want to hear this, but I think I'm going to start playing golf. And Nikki knows what that means. Nikki knows that there is no doing things halfway. There is no, I'm going to go and just get the cheapest and just get by. Right? I got into fishing. I bought a boat. All right? I go through these spells and it gets big, right? Really fast. That's how I am. I want to do things all in or nothing. Either do it big or don't do it at all. That's the way I look at it. Like, if I'm gonna play basketball, man, I'm gonna have Jordans on. You know what I'm saying? Like, because that makes me jump higher. I'm telling you, when I do stuff, I'm doing it all in or don't do it at all. The men in Hebrews chapter 11 and the individuals that are in this chapter, they did it all in. That's what I love about them, is because, man, I can see glimpses of people that just says, listen, I'm going to be all in or nothing. And so as I did this study, man, there are people that I look at and I say, I get why they are here. I get it. Man, you look at guys like Noah. Noah, all right, let's talk about Noah just for a second. Noah built an ark. That's big time. You belong in Hebrews chapter 11. An important guy. The Lord basically looked down and he says, okay, the entire world is wicked, so I'm going to use Noah to start over. You belong in Hebrews chapter 11, my friend. Then there's Abraham. Abraham, I want you to go to a land that I'm going to show you. Go home and tell your wife, tomorrow you are moving. He did that. That alone, Hebrews chapter 11. If you can go home and tell your wife, tomorrow we're moving, I don't know where we're going, I don't know how we're going to get there, and I don't know what I'm going to do when I get there, you belong in Hebrews chapter 11, all right? I'm telling you, there are some people that I say, hey, they belong there. Moses' mom, she puts her baby boy in a basket and pushes him down the river, and then Moses grows up, as we well know, and leads the children of Israel out of Egypt and out of bondage. He belongs in Hebrews chapter 11. Now, there is this one character in Hebrews chapter 11, and he's right away, and he happens in verse 5. And it says this, and by faith, Enoch was taken up so that he should not see death. And when he was not found, because God had taken him, now before he was taken, he was commended as having pleased God. You say, well, Enoch, I don't remember him slaying any giants. I don't remember him building any boats. I don't remember him hiding any spies. I don't remember this guy anywhere. Well, we find him a couple places in Scripture. One is in Genesis chapter 5, and I want you to flip over there because, man, this guy, his life is interesting. His life is interesting because we don't know a lot about him, but we have a couple verses here in Genesis chapter 5. Genesis chapter 5 and verse 21. The Word of God reads this, and when Enoch had lived 65, he fathered Methuselah. Enoch walked with God after he fathered Methuselah 300 years, and he had other sons and daughters. Thus, all the days of Enoch were 365. Verse 24, Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. The end. That's what we know about Enoch. We have one more reference to him in Jude, and it's really just one verse of Scripture in verse 14/15, because it tells what he did, but it basically said that he prophesied. But that's all we know about this guy. And I read in Hebrews chapter 11, and when I get to Hebrews chapter 11, and I read guys that built arks, I read guys that led a group of people out of Egypt, out of bondage. I read about people that hid spies and protected them, and I say, Hebrews 11 worthy. Then there's this guy, Enoch, and all he did was walk with God. And you know what I see in Enoch? Something we can be. Here's the honest truth. I'm not foreseeing God calling me to build an ark anytime soon where he's going to flood the earth. One, because he's already said that he's not going to do that. Two, I don't see me being obedient enough to go home and tell my wife, Nikki, we are moving tomorrow. I don't know where we're going, but God says we're moving. So I don't see me landing in Hebrews 11 there. I'm not foreseeing me hiding any spies anytime soon. I haven't been called to lead a group of people out of bondage. But walk with God. This is something I can do. Graduates, this is something you can do. The day doesn't end here. Because here's the thing, we can do this. I began to ask myself the next question, if there were a Hebrews 14. And there isn't a Hebrews 14, but let's hypothetically say there were. And Hebrews 14 were to be the heroes of the faith of this generation. My question is this, would we be in it? Would we be in it? Would God look down and say, man, Tony Craddock, men of faith, hero of the faith, Hebrews 14, he's in. More directly, is Stephen in? And I look at all these individuals and I see that they did things that were unbelievable. And then I see Enoch. man, that walk with God. Let's talk about walk just for a minute. The Bible has defined walk as an expression of fellowship and obedience. All right, that's how scholars have defined this idea of walk. It's an expression of fellowshipping with God and being obedient to God. Okay, so I think there's a couple things that we have to identify about walking. All right, a few things that you have to do when you begin to walk. One is we have to agree on the place that we're going to walk. What I mean by that is, man, we have to identify if we are going to walk somewhere. If we're all going to take a big walk, we'd have to agree where we were going to go to walk. Were we going to walk on a treadmill? Were we going to walk around the church until we got tired? Are we going to go down to the high school and walk on the track? We would have to agree on a place where we are going to walk together. All right? That's one thing we have to agree on. Two is the pace. Now, here's the thing about pace. Man, I'm telling you, Nikki gets on to me all the time because she says I leave her. Now, here is the honest truth. She doesn't walk fast enough. I don't leave her. She just walks really slow, especially around Christmas shopping time. Listen, when it's Christmas shopping time, I have focus, okay? My pace is if I'm to get to that microphone, then I'm not stopping at the plant. I'm walking straight to the microphone because that's the objective, right? That's the objective. You don't go here and say, I'm walking to the microphone and stop at the stand, the tree, the plant, the monitor there, and then get to the microphone. We go straight to the microphone. Nikki, this is what Nikki does. We're walking to the microphone. We stop here, then we stop at this plant. Then we go to the tissues over here. Then we stop at this stand for a while, and then we finally get to the monitor. And then we get to the microphone. The pace gets all bent out of shape a little bit. When we begin to walk, we have to agree on a pace that we're all walking the same. You see, here's the thing about Enoch. We don't know a lot about him, but we know he was a walker because the Bible tells us that he walked with God, and he walked in such a way that it pleased God. So let's talk about how he did that. Let's talk about methods where we can do that, because here's the thing. These are things we have to agree on. I think we have to agree on the place. We have to agree on the pace. Yeah, I think that we have to agree on a lot of things when it comes to walking, but I think, man, there's just something about this walk. What makes this walk different? What made Enoch so different? I've pictured in my mind 100 times about this guy, Enoch, since I started this study. I imagine being his friend. Somewhere there is a friend that is guilty of killing poor Enoch. Somewhere, I'm honest, there had to be a buddy, there was somebody that was around him around the time that Enoch was walking and then he was not. Have you ever thought about that poor guy? Right, really, he's walking with his buddy one day and now all of a sudden Enoch is not. He goes home and says, I don't really know what happened to Enoch. Like that story's ever gonna fly. You know, there had to be somebody that was responsible for this Enoch disappearing act that happened here. But that's exactly what happened. You see, here's the honest truth. For me and for you, there are really two destinations. Our exit strategy is one of two ways. One is we die. Most of us will do that. Number two, and hopefully, is the rapture, that the Lord returns. That's exit strategy number two. For Enoch, it was a little bit different. He's just walking along one day. The Bible says that he walked with the Lord, and then he was not. Then he was no more. You know what I tend to think is that the Lord looked down at Enoch, and he saw his life, and he says, this guy, Enoch, needs to be here. He needs to be here. A couple things about this guy, Enoch, that we don't know a lot about is he had a visible walk. What we do know from Genesis is that at 65, he has Methuselah, and he lived to be 365. So for 300 plus years, he had a visible walk with God. 365 years. Listen, let me tell you, let me speak to the older adults for just a second. The excuses that I've done it too long, out the window with this guy. 365 years, he walked with God. That's what he did. He had fellowship, and he obeyed God. That's what he did for 365 years. You say, well, what made him so special? Well, for 365 years, he walked with God and he pleased God, and God found it to be good. God says, what you're doing is good. Now, here's the honest truth, and I mentioned earlier, we probably aren't going to build an ark anytime soon. But let me tell you what we can do. We can walk in such a way that it pleases God. And you know what I think? I think that he is going to be just as pleased with us as he is Noah and Moses. And you say, well, I don't know about that. Hebrews 11, he made the list. He made the list. And what he did was he walked in such a way that pleased God. His fellowship, his obedience was in such a way that God said, this guy gets it. The more I looked at Enoch's life, the more it became clear what I want for mine. I want people to look at my life and say, he walks with God. I want those closest to me to say, he walks with God. I want my wife to say, he walks with God. I want my little girl to say, he walks with God. I want my church to say, he walks with God. Sometimes I think we get this all out of whack, by the way. I think we start and say, I want my church to say, I walk with God. And then we fail to recognize the significance of your wife knowing that you walk with God, or your spouse knowing that you walk with God, or your children knowing that you walk with God. Listen, that's where it begins, by the way. That's where it begins. That's where it's most important. It was visible to those around him. I believe that when people saw Enoch, they said, that guy loves Jesus. That guy walks with Jesus every day. Now, does that mean Enoch probably walked around with a Christian t-shirt every day? Probably not. But what I think was his characteristics, his mannerisms, the way he lived his life was in such a way that people visibly saw what it was like to fellowship and to be obedient to Almighty God. In such a way that it pleased God. It pleased him. That God looked down and he says, okay, this is one of the most faithful people on the planet. Enoch. Enoch. Enoch didn't write a book of the Bible. Enoch didn't lead people out of bondage. Enoch didn't build a boat. Enoch didn't kill a giant. Enoch didn't hide spies. Enoch walked with God. Church, I think there's something to be said about a church that walks with God. Because you know what I believe with my whole heart? I believe it pleases God. Graduates, hear me out. Hear me out. I think this is especially effective to you. You're going to have an opportunity in the upcoming months as you start fresh for the others that you come in contact with to visibly see you walk with God. My challenge is this: will you do it? Will you say, what you see is what you get? You see, I think there's a couple problems here. I think there are some that put on a front that says, hey, I walk with God, and they're farther from the truth. The reality is this: you don't make Hebrews 11, you don't walk with God, and then you are not if you're putting on a front. Because you can fool your preacher, you can fool your mom and dad, you can visibly, everybody can say they must walk with God, but the reality is this: unless you do, it all mean nothing but a hill of beans. I mean, it's nothing. That and 50 cents will get you a cup of coffee. Maybe. But I think this is a message far greater than just graduates. Church, we got to stop changing the rules. We got to stop playing games. If we say that we walk with God, then we've got to walk with him. It's got to be visible for the world to see. It's got to be visible for those who know us best to see. It was visible. For 365 years, it says that Enoch walked with God. I think there's a couple reasons why we don't. I think the pace gets messed up. I talked about pace earlier. A lot of times in our faith, this is what we do. We start off and we get excited. Maybe it's a service. Maybe it's a worship service. Maybe it's a revival. Maybe it's just that moment in your quiet time where you said, I've had a come to Jesus meeting. And we start out like a bullet out of a gun. And we're excited and we're reading our Bibles and we're trying to read the entire book of Matthew in one day. And I'm telling you, we're excited. And then 3 weeks from now, our pace, we started off so fast and so hard that we're tired and we're give out. Enoch's pace was steady. You say, how do you know? Because he did it for 365 years. That's a steady pace. That's a consistent pace. Within the church, we've gotten away from the significance and the importance of consistency, of a steady walk with Him, one that doesn't change. Does that mean that we're not going to be happier in some days and sadder on some? No, it doesn't mean that. We're still going to have ups and downs, but it means that we continually walk with Him through those ups and downs. It means that we say, man, despite what happens in my life, I'm going to be consistently, and I'm going to consistently walk with Him. There's just something about His walk. I think that it was visible. He had a visible walk. He didn't have just a visible walk, but He had a vocal walk. I mentioned the book of Jude. Jude, verse 14 and 15, said that He was a prophet. That's really all we know about Him. What that means is that He wasn't a secret Christian. What that means is He wasn't secret about His faith. That means that He told other people about what God had already done. Here's the deal. A lot of times we want it to be visible to God. We want others to be visible for God. But here's the reality is when it comes to being vocal about God, we're hushed. We are hushed. And I ask the question, why? If we're walking like Enoch walked, that means we're visible and we're vocal. I think what we've done in the church is we've said, okay, I'll take one of the two. I'll either be the vocal one that doesn't really want to be visible, that doesn't really want to be consistent, or I'll be the one that wears a Christian t-shirt but then really don't live it and don't teach it. Amos chapter 3, verse 3, it basically says, can two walk together if they do not agree? I love that statement, especially when it comes to Enoch, because when he walked with God, you better believe that he agreed with God. And it makes a difference. Listen, it makes a difference. It defines who you are. I want to be known as someone who walks in such a way that God is pleased. I told a story about Thomas Edison. At the death of Thomas Edison was getting ready to die. And his wife leaned over and said, honey, are you afraid? And he said, no, I'm not, because of my walk matched my talk. I think about Enoch. We miss part of this story if we regret and we fail to talk about he was taken up to be with God as a reward. I firmly believe that God rewards us when we faithfully walk for Him. I firmly believe that. Am I preaching that God is going to give you riches and fame? No, I am not. And I won't do it with a smile on my face when I say, no, I will not. But what I will say is I believe that the Lord is pleased. You say, well, how do you say that, preacher? Well, he was pleased with Enoch's walk, so he can be pleased with ours. You see, I think when I read Hebrews 11, sometimes I say, these guys did things that I can never do. Superstars, if you will. Superheroes of the faith, guys that did the incredible, the unthinkable acts. Hebrews 11 guy. And then there's Enoch, and all he did was walk faithfully with God, and it pleased God in such a way that he says, this guy is faithful. This guy is faithful. I think there's a couple things for us this morning. I think we need to check our pace for some of you. Check how we're walking. Are we consistently, faithfully having fellowship and obedience to God Almighty? And for some, I think it's been a long time since we've had a visible, vocal type walk with God Almighty. That others said, there is something different about them. I don't know what it is quite yet, but I got to know. I got to know. And by the way, we don't get too old. If Enoch was 350, man, I got a long ways to go. I long for the Lord to be pleased with my walk. But not just my walk, the walk of our church. The individuals in our church, each and every one of us, the Lord looks at us and says, I'm pleased. I'm pleased. I'm pleased. I'm pleased. Pleased. Now, as your pastor, I don't hope the Lord starts taking you all up because that hurts attendance, kind of. But what I hope is that we receive the benefit of what it means to walk in such a way that it gets the Lord's attention. For Enoch, this guy that just faithfully, consistently walked with God was looked at as one of the most faithful people in the entire world. How is our walk? Let's stand for prayer. Lord, what an interesting set of worship that you put together this morning. We honor our graduates, and I'm thankful for them, and I'm thankful for their accomplishments. You led us, and you orchestrated within our worship an incredible worship service. And then you challenged us to walk in such a way that pleases you. It's an interesting mix. But Lord, I'm just dumb enough to believe that you orchestrated every second of it. Because as we seek your face each and every week, I believe that you've put this service together. You have brought us together. And you have challenged us to walk like Enoch. Lord, we don't know much about him, but we know he was faithful. So Lord, maybe this morning, maybe there's a graduate, maybe not just a graduate, maybe there's an individual that says, man, I want to walk in such a way that it pleases my God. I'm going to get back to a consistent pace. I want walking for you to define who I am. You see, I tend to think, and it's silly in a way, I tend to think the Hebrews 11 guys are walking around with a patch that says Hebrews 11. But Lord, at the end of the day, I don't think it matters to them anymore. Because if they were faithful here on this earth, they are faithful to worship you and do exactly what you've called them to do. So Lord, I look at us and I look at us as a church and I ask this question. Do we walk like Enoch? Do we walk in a way that pleases you? If not, Lord, let us worship. And let us come to an altar, let us do it at our seat, regardless of how we do it, but may we walk away saying, my walk is forever changed. My walk is going to be visible. My walk is going to be vocal. But regardless of the pace, regardless of the place, regardless of the path I take, I want it to please you. I want it to please you. So here in just a moment, we're going to worship together and this altar is open, man. And may we
walk like Enoch, because Enoch's walk pleased you, and we long to please you. I thank you.